Johannesburg, and I am the head of research at Andani Africa. And as part of the work I do at Andani Africa, I am the other half of the two founders of Open Restitution Africa, together with the amazing Chao Tayang. Chao and I work to think about how we might use information, data, and transparency around information to support restitution processes with a focus on what Africa needs and what Africans need from the restitution process.
My name is Chao Tayana Maina. I am a co-founder of the Open Restitution Africa project and a founder of African Digital Heritage. One of the reasons why we started Open Restitution was to really understand and enable others to understand what the complexities of the restitution process are, who is involved, and how we can use data to actually inform returns and restitution on the African continent. Now, it's one thing to look for data online, which there is some of, but really not a lot of. And we have noticed that there are a lot of gaps within the data, particularly that we have found online. So the purpose of this workshop today is really to understand the actual experience of working within restitution from people who have worked within restitution. We've been very privileged to be joined by people who've worked outside museums and people who've worked within museums. And they've helped us really understand what are the stakeholders involved, what are the things that we need to factor in.
The argument is that they were not illegally taken away, they were actually sold to the museum. So how do you now deal with a situation like that?
My name is Dr. Purity Kiura, a Chief Research Scientist with the National Museums of Kenya. I've been working on restitution for the last 4 or so years, starting from around 2015, when I had the first contact of objects that were being brought back to Kenya from a museum in the United States. And these objects were what we call vigangos. These are carved wooden statues owned by the Mijikenda of the coast of Kenya. And they were taken away in the 1990s by art collectors. But these objects are of cultural value, they are not of commercial value. So I've been working with institutions mainly in America to bring them back. We've had success stories where we've brought about 30 of those items back. And also this year, 37 more were brought from Illinois State Museum. And we are also expecting about, I think, 50 more from different other museums in America. These objects are of cultural value, mainly to the people who made them and also who used them for traditions and cultures and for practices. And it's our responsibility to make sure that that ownership is recognized by people who have taken them away and that they are returned to the people so that they can continue with their own traditions and practices using those objects.
The issue of sharing is not gonna stop once you bring everything. You still get to a point where you also want to share your history and your cultures and whatever you have.
One thing I also realized is that the efforts were being made behind closed doors. Mm-hmm. And for me, I'm an activist, so I'm a very loud person. I'm like, I thought to myself, I mean, when these colonial atrocities were being committed, they were loud. Mm-hmm. Why should we begin to have these conversations behind closed doors as if we're petting somebody or we're afraid of somebody or we don't want people to know that we're having these conversations?
My name is Njobati Sylvie Vernier. I'm from Cameroon. I'm the founder of CCLs of Fame, which is an organization that's promoting intercultural dialogue through art, culture, and indigenous sport. I am also an activist, so my work is focused on social justice, and I seek to inspire people to confront the colonial past through the works that I do with focus on restitution. My involvement in restitution started from a personal journey. I went out on this journey seeking to, you know, dismantle the multiple identity crises that I had faced. So as a person, I went out to my grandfather to speak to him, to know much about me. And then he did mention to me that, look, all the questions you're asking me now, the answers is in your ability to understand your history, where you come from. And so in that conversation, we talked about Gonzo. And Gonzo happens to be the founder of Nsok people and is an object that has very strong spiritual meaning. And he also then told me that Gonzo was taken away to Germany during the colonial times, and his wish is to see it come back before he passes on. And so that's how I got involved in restitution. So for me, it was also about fulfilling his wish to ensure that Gonzo comes back for him to see before he passes on. And unfortunately, he passed on without really seeing the return of Gonzo. But then I'm happy that we have recorded a success, and in the months ahead, Gonzo will be coming back home. It's very important, the work Open Restitution Africa is doing to ensure data availability in the processes of restitution, because it's also about understanding how it had happened in the past. It's also about learning from other restitution processes in order to facilitate and improve pending restitution cases. So information, data is very, very important. And also the availability of information permits us as activists, academia, artists, to provide solutions that are evidence-based, which is very, very important in the question of restitution. As we seek to, you know, dismantle the usual delay tactic of provenance research, information data availability is very, very important in facilitating the processes of restitution.
My name is Bilunomi Wheeler, and I'm a data scientist. The role of a data scientist is to look at information and look at data in order to be able to inform better decision making. I work at a company called Lelapa.ai, and at Lelapa we're just really passionate about using the African way to solve African problems through using AI technologies. So from a data scientist perspective, it's always really important to have domain knowledge of the problem that you're looking at and the problem that you're looking to unpack or to solve. So being part of this workshop has been really useful to understand the intricacies of what Open Restitution is trying to achieve with regards to the returns and requests process, but also especially just in terms of understanding where this problem is coming from, the type of people involved, and the type of things that we're interested in learning. I think the merge of the technical world and the social science world is quite a difficult intersection to achieve successfully, but I think it is very difficult to enact social change in any kind of way without evidence. And data is one of the ways in which you're able to obtain evidence for insights that can then bring about decisions that cause impact and result in change.
Hello, my name is Yokao Mutonga. I work on the Open Restitution Africa project in the research department. I've been doing this work since February, and most of my work revolves around collecting all the available online data. In this first season of the work, it involves collecting all the online data on restitution on the continent. After doing that, we now decided to create a framework where we look at, when you look at the data that exists on how restitution work has been done, a lot of it is based off of the museums in Europe or in America. We don't have a platform that centers the voices of Africans, the voices of these communities now talking about what this object means to them, how many times they've asked for it, and how they'd like to have it come back. So we created a different type of framework that centers on the request that a community made or an individual made. And we did two case studies. We did one for the Benin bronzes, because those are the most popular objects that museums are trying to return. And then we also decided to do a case study based on an object that's not very common, like the vigango here in Kenya. And so after putting together these two frameworks, it began to emerge that, one, we need people who know a bit more about how to mine data that is not available online, or what questions you need to be asking so you can find everything that you need in regard to a request. Because the end result of the work that we're doing is to have a platform where all the data that is needed to inform people to make requests and have returns come back is available in this platform. That's what we've been doing.
We have audiences at different levels of speciality. There are audiences who would like to know exactly how a restitution process takes place, and there are audiences who would like to know how many returns have happened. The data platform that we eventually build will need to cater for the different kinds of specialities of the audiences that we have.
So with the restitution
process, it's not one process. There's many different ways that restitution can happen. Many different rules, government laws, different kinds of museums, different kinds of objects or human remains. And because there is so much variation, but also because it's not very transparent or open, it's very difficult to know what the rules are, what are the possibilities, where things are, what is where. And we really need a lot more clarity about how to make the process a better process. So we're really interested in using technology available to us to try and open up what is otherwise quite a closed conversation, so that people from across the continent can play a role understanding what restitution really entails. Because often we know that we want our stuff back, but what that means, how that works, is much more complex, and we're really interested in open data to enable that to happen better.
So today what we're really here for is to unpack this problem, to sort out the specifics and the details of how we can go about making this process for easier for other people who would like to do the same thing.
Having passed through a full restitution process myself, well, not very full, but almost a full restitution process, I've come to understand the importance of data, and this workshop is really something that is needed. It's a timely project.
Really just blows my mind to see the amazing work that people across the continent are doing, to understand how complex the work that they're trying to do is, and how committed many people are to doing very difficult work that keeps them up at night, but to continue to do that work really importantly. And I think that it's really helped me also understand that we're really at the beginning of the process of restitution. I think in places like Europe, they think we're coming to the end of the fight because things are being returned. But what we know in Africa is that this is just the beginning, because having things back is just the start of a very long and difficult process that we have to be responsible for, and we have to find answers for.